Let's give the first timers a hand again, shall we? Check. If you don't have a Bible, raise your hand. We'll get one to you. Thank you, Lord. Check. Testing 1, 2. If you turn your song sheets over, you will see that we have some thoughts there. Boy, it's a full house today. Next week, the 12th, is Purim, the Feast of Lots, or the Feast of Esther, Hadasha in the Hebrew. This is the month. Next week is the day where God will deliver yet again the Hebrews from a demonic policy enacted in the Persian Empire, a preview to the Holocaust. God will deliver them. The book of Esther comes alive. And this month, specifically next week, is when Hadashah, Esther, would actually, the queen, she will actually approach the throne uninvited at great consequence. And we will see the mercies of God extended. And God will then deliver the Jewish people from the provinces that begin all the way in India and matriculates all the way through to Afghanistan, modern-day Afghanistan, up to the Caucasus. This is that season. And so we always have our tallit out. As Judeo-Christians, Christian Hebraics, I have my tallit out. You see the shofar. If you are planning on making it to service on Sunday, bring a plate with you. We're going to have brunch. We'll start at 9 o'clock. We'll have brunch. The setup's going to be somewhat unique. Your fellow ambassador preparation, we're ambassadors of Christ if you surrendered to him. Your fellow ambassador prep for next week is reading through the book of Esther, because we will go through it together next week, and we will celebrate what the Jewish people have been celebrating for millenniums. And in this Christian fellowship, Christian Hebraics, we stand with the Hebrews. We love the Jews. We stand with them here. Why? I can give you many reasons, but the main reason being our Messiah, Jesus Christ, is the quintessential Jew, the Lion from the tribe of Judah. So how can you not love the Jewish people? Somebody said amen. So I'm looking forward to it. Please come by, read the book of Esther this week, 10 chapters, and then we'll delve into it together. With no further ado, open please with me to the Gospel of Jesus according to Matthew. The Gospel of Jesus according to Matthew chapter 12. Matthew chapter 12. I'm going to ask you to one more time, let's stand together for the reading of the Word of God. Matthew chapter 12, verses 1 to verse 21. At that time, read with me, Jesus went through the grain fields on Shabbat, and his Talmudim disciples were hungry and began to pluck heads of grain and to eat. And when the Pharisees saw it, they said to him, "Look, your disciples are doing what is not lawful to do on Shabbat." But he said to them, "Have you not read what David did when he was hungry, he and those who were with him? How he entered the house of God and ate the showbread, which was not lawful for him to eat, nor for those who were with him, but only for the priests, Or have you not read in Torah that on Shabbat, the Kohen Kotanim, the priest in temple, profane the Shabbat and are blameless? Yet I say to you that in this place, say it, there is one that is greater than the temple. But if you had known what this means, I desire mercy and not sacrifice, you would not have condemned the guiltless. For the Son of Man is Lord even of the Shabbat. Now when he had departed from there, he went into synagogue. And behold, there was a man with a withered hand. And they asked him, saying, Is it lawful to heal on Shabbat, that they might accuse him? Then he said to them, What man is there among you who has one sheep, and if it falls into a pit on Shabbat, will not lay hold of it and lift it out? Of how much more value then is a man than a sheep? Therefore it is lawful to do good on Shabbat. Then he said to the man, Stretch out your hand. And he stretched it out, and it was restored as whole as the others. Then the Pharisees went out and plotted against him, how they might destroy him. But when Yeshua knew it, he withdrew from there, and great multitudes followed him, and he healed them all. Yet he warned them not to make him known, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah HaNabah, saying, Behold my servant whom I have chosen, my beloved in whom my soul is well pleased. I will put my ruach upon him. He will declare justice to the goyim. He will not quarrel nor cry out, nor will anyone hear his voice in the streets. A bruised reed he will not break, and a smoking flax he will not quench, till he sends forth justice to victory, and in his name the uncovenanted will trust. Lord, we thank you for your word today. We thank you for your mercies. We thank you for your tender grace, your tender healings. We thank you, Lord, for the very fact that you know our wiring, for you made us, Yehovah Bara, and you know exactly how to approach us. We thank you, Lord, for fresh mercies that rolls in every morning, fresh and brand new, even as the prophet said in Lamentations. Lord, we surrender to your word. And even as Kirk prayed, Lord, we pray for a great hunger in the republic, Lord, in this nation for your word. We thank you that you hold us together by the word of your power and by your love, by your aloha today. In the name of Jesus. Somebody said amen. Would you just hug somebody before you sit down? Just turn around and hug somebody. Thank you. Hug somebody, yes.
My buddy. Good to see you. Thank you, sweetie. Can I get a kiss right here? Right here. Thank you.
Elijah, my buddy. Hallelujah. Your notes will actually articulate, if you see it, the title of our discourse, The Burden of the Lord This Morning. Read it with me. Messiah Yeshua's Compassion and Tender Mercies. Hope for the hurting. Hope for the hurting. Jesus is radical compassion for the broken. His radical and his immense compassion, his tender healings towards those who are shattered or at the brink of shipwreck. Remember this as we delve into the subject this morning. Looking back, chapter 12, he and his disciples, they're on their way to, they're timing this, they're en route to synagogue. And as they go, the disciples are hungry. You read it. I read it. And as they are hungry, there's a path through the vineyard. There's a path through the grain field, if you may. And they begin to pluck. They begin to pluck heads of grain to eat. This is not something that qualifies as theft as it would be in the Western world. This in and of itself is God's mercy and provision. Keep your finger there and go with me to Deuteronomy chapter 23. Go to Deuteronomy chapter 23 towards your left so you see it. Now you try to do this in the West and it's a whole different scenario. But God had made provision for this particular need. It exemplifies the mercies of God, the tender healings, God's kindness, God's goodness. In Deuteronomy, in the Torah, if you may, chapter 23, look at verses 24 and 25. Read with me. Ready? And go. When you come into your neighbor's vineyard, you may eat your fill of grapes at your pleasure, but you shall not put any in your container. God has made a provision for this. If you are hungry and you're meandering by, you can eat from your neighbor's field, but don't fill it into a backpack or a container. You can stay there until you eat till your pleasure, till your hunger has been satisfied, and then you move on. This is a particular policy that God has given to the Hebrews. Why? Because they themselves are pilgrims. They're sojourners. So God's reminding them, hey, don't be so haughty. You yourself, I called Abraham out of Iraq, and I gave them this land, and you are people in transition. And so when people come by, be kind to them along the way. And so he's actually reminding them of this. Look at verse 25. Read with me. When you come into your neighbor's standing grain, say it, you may pluck the heads with your hand, but you shall not use a sickle on your neighbor's standing grain. You can, same thing, as you're hungry, pluck something, but don't take stuff with you. Don't grab a sickle, put it down to its roots, and then hoist this stuff away. Can't do it. That's a no-no. But you, if you're hungry, partake of this and then move on. That's pretty amazing, isn't it? That's exactly what the disciples were doing, and that's why Jesus didn't chide them, because they were fulfilling this. But I want you to note that an accusation was hurled from the Pharisees, who normally conflicted with the Sadducees, and they just really couldn't see, you know. And so the accusation that was hurled between verses 1 and verse 2, look, your Talmudim, as we were reading, you will notice that I'm inserting Hebrew words here and there. When you see Jesus in your English Bible, remember Yehoshua in the Hebrew, which literally means they're calling him Yeshua, the New Testament variation of Joshua. They're calling him the salvation of the Lord, because that's what Yehoshua means. When you mention Jesus, the derivative from the Greek Yesus, you miss something if you're not aware of it. So every time you see Jesus, just say the salvation of the Lord, and all of a sudden, for some 30 years, they've been calling him the salvation of the Lord. And his calling is in his name. Salvation isn't a program. It's a person. It's Jesus Christ himself. I am the salvation. There, no one can come to Avinu except through me. I am God's salvation program for the entire world. Me, this person who entered into your domain, waddled in a manger, wrapped in a cloth and all this stuff, it's me. And so always remember this. This truth has been lost. The disciples and Jesus was actually, the accusation being not that they partook of what was provisionally given and allowed, but that they did this on Shabbat. Look, your Talmudim, your disciples, are doing what is not lawful to do on Shabbat. That's the theme here. That you can be so strident in your interpretation of the law that you forget the spirit of the law. God desires mercy more than sacrifice. Somebody said amen. And many are this way. There's a polarization here. In our denominations, there's a polarization. There are many who just stick to the law and forget the spirit. And there are those who are given to the spirit, but they're not in the law. And so you need both. You need to be aware of the word of God, but be flowing in mercy as well. Jesus would chide them chapters later. You are tithing in everything, and mint and cumin and cinnamon, but yet you are forgetting justice and mercy. So do both. Don't just walk in the law. Have the spirit of the lawgiver, which is mercy as well. Don't just glory in sacrifice. Walk out in justice and mercy. That's a balance that we're always called to walk in. Through Shlomo
Vimelech, through King Solomon. God said that God, in Proverbs chapter 10, God abhors an unbalanced scale. God looks at the unbalance in our lives and he abhors it. Either we are this way or we are that way. God wants to strike us right in the middle. There's a need for balance in the house of God, for the creed of God and for the charisma of God, for the right doctrine. That's important, to have good doctrine. But you got to have doctrine and duty. You got to flesh the word of God out and not just something that is parked in your cerebral. The word has got to become flesh and walked out, not just kept in, incubated, and of great robbery to yourself and those around you. And so he mentions the whole thing of David here. Have you forgotten that David and his band of motley crew, when they were hungry, they came into the house of God while Abiathar was the priest, and they partook because they were hungry? Now, you got to understand this. I want you to be aware of this particular case, because if not, it would be aloof to you. Just write in your notes Leviticus. Leviticus 24. Leviticus 24, verse 5 to verse 9. God had commanded the Hebrews to always, from evening to morning, Erev to Bokeh, to have two rows of 12 loaves on the table of showbread. The loaves were made of fine flour, flour that have been sieved through 11 times, 11 types of sieve. And so they would always have the 12 breads. That's prophetic symbology of the tribes and the apostles and so on and so forth. 12 is a governmental number. But yet when the sun would set, they would take the old 12 out and put the new 12 in. That's the old 12 is what David actually came and partook of. There it is right there. It's left over from the day before. Us Americans, us Westerners go, our day begins from morning towards evening. The biblical calendar, the Chabad, God's calendar begins from evening to morning. That's Genesis code. It was the evening and the morning of the first day. It was the evening and the morning second day, not morning and evening. So when you and I think that our day has just begun, we've already been robbed. It's already been halfway through. God's already begun something. When you were asleep, he was doing something. And so be aware of this. Be aware of that. That's why a lot of the Jews are always ahead, pun intended, because the calendar sets them that way. And so David and his crew comes in, and they partake of the bread set the day after, and then the new bread's put out. And so Yeshua reminds them of this. And so he moves on. The accusation is made between verses 1 and verse 2. Can you say accusation? The answer to the accusation is between verse 3 and verse 8. He gives the answer there between verse 3 and verse 8. All right, let's read here in verse 7. If you had known what this means, say it. I desire, say it, mercy and not sacrifice. This verse is telling. If you are not aware of the mercies of God through your life, towards you, through you, then you will adopt a very haughty and staunch attitude towards others. One who is always forgetful of mercy will always be judgmentally unrighteous in their observation and judgment towards others. A debtor of mercy who understands it, yeah, I will make an observation, but I'll be very kind with it, because I know that you and I stand by the grace of God alone. Are you there? How there is such a dearth, there is a need and appreciation for the mercies of God again. Because if not, sacrifices, you can sacrifice all day, but God desires mercy. Obedience is better than sacrifice. Some would argue sacrifice is better than obedience. Watch it. If that's you, you belong to the white knuckle club, Christianity, constipation Christianity, then it's time to kind of shape that off. Because the mercies of God, you just got to go, God loved me while I was yet a sinner. He loved me and died for me, demonstrated he's the Lord towards me, and I need to reconcile to that reality. The problem with perfectionists is they become a standard to themselves and they become a god to themselves. Perfectionism is all about imagery. But ladies and gentlemen, the mercies of God, we have been completed by that tetelestai, the completed work of Christ upon that cross. That's perfection right there. And God says, don't worry, I'll take you as you are, and I will then iron out the wrinkles and make you more like me. You just surrender to me, and I'll do the job. Are you there? And that's the beautiful thing about the gospel. We got people, we got Christians, we got denominations that are parked in this thing, and it's so sad. You can smell them 3 hours away or 3 zip codes away. You can smell this stuff, and you don't want to be there. The action that was given is in verse 9 to verse 11, if you're taking notes. The accusation hurled between verses 1 and 2. The answer was given, verse 3 to verse 8. And the action of Christ is what we're looking at here in verse 9 to verse 11. Notice the setup. They weren't satisfied with the response that he gave them. That the disciples, it's qualified as work. Up to this moment, they were so strident on the Shabbat rules that there were 39 rules set up just for the Sabbath alone. 39. And this was a violation. You cannot do a good thing on Shabbat. You cannot. You know, if you did, you broke the Shabbat. You can only walk 11 paces. The 12th pace, you're working. And so they would go with meals with booths, Sukkot, and they would build every 11th step. They would build a booth, and 11th step, and build a booth. On a technicality, they say, where'd you come from? I came 5 miles away. You were working on Shabbat. No, I came from my home. Technically, every 11th step is good. 12th step is working. So look, 5 miles long, there is about 100 booths that I can technically say, that's my home. And so I'm not working. I'm just walking, you know. And so it's ridiculous. And this is one of the things that they threw out at Yeshua, a statement to be aware of. Look at verse 8. The Son of Man is Lord, even of the, say it. What's important to God on that particular day is that you exemplify, you walk in mercy always. Don't be constrained to that day and heed the law and forget about the heartbeat of the law. Now, the setup here, right? They brought a guy with a withered hand and they snuck him into synagogue. If you understand Jewish history, you understand a man with a withered hand, a deformity, is not allowed in synagogue. He's actually on the outside. But they snuck him in, and the plot thickens, because when Yeshua comes in, and they are now, they're more concerned about their laws and their rules, 39 of them on every Sabbath, than they are in mercy. And when he had departed, verse 9, from there, he went into synagogue, and behold, there was a man with a withered hand. Every Jew, when reading that, will just stop and go, something's wrong with this picture. A man with a withered hand cannot be in synagogue, okay? On the outer perimeters, but not inside. So this is a setup. And they asked him, notice, is it lawful to heal on Shabbat, that they may accuse him? That's the plot here. The conspiracy thickens, okay? Then he said to them, what man is there among you who has one sheep? And if it falls into a pit on Shabbat, will not lay hold of it and lift it? Of how much more value then is a man than a sheep? That's a good ethics question. Are human beings more valuable than animals? It's a sad reality that bald eagles and many other creatures on the endangered species have more rights than an unborn child. Yeshua would look at this and he would wince at it. This is not right. He wouldn't smile. He'd frown at this. Of what, who has more value, the animal made by God or the human, the crown creation? How can we say that humans are the crown creation of God? Because after he created, Yatzah, formed Adam from the Adama, from the earth, and he breathed into him the Ruach and he became alive, God stopped creating. God said, it is very good. The only time he said, very good. Every other time, it is good, it is good, it is good. After Adam came upon the earth, and he didn't speak man into existence, he handled him, he created. He spoke everything else. Let there be light, and light was. But when he came to Adam, he could have said, let there be men. And no, he said, no, 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 no. I'm going to handle this. And so God handles men, the outer skeletal and the anatomy, the anatomy within the embroidery, he handles. And the word is, and God made man. And the word in the Hebrew, yatsah, is equal to a potter who is molding clay. No wonder the prophet said, you are the potter and we are the clay. No wonder Paul says, we are earthen vessels. No wonder humanity has always been, in the language of Karl Marx, incurably religious, because we yearn for the supernatural. Why? Because the supernatural handled us from our point of antiquity. There's a craving in us for the supernatural. He's got his fingerprints all over us. But Yeshua is the fulfillment. He's the one that brings us into, eclipses into the Father's domain. And there's a unison there that is unequivocal, unparalleled. Somebody said amen. And so, yes, when God created livestock, domestic and wild, he didn't stop, did he? He didn't say it was very good. It was good. When God created Bambi, when he created, you know, all this, you know, Shamu and Nemo, they're still looking for that little fish. Humu humu nuunu apua, big name for a small fish. He didn't stop. He kept going. Every new creation was a greater domino effect, a greater, you know, expression in quality and in kind, until humanity was created, Adam. And after Adam was created, God says, it is very good, and God takes a break, enters into a Shabbat, rests. That's why we say, biblically, that humans are the crown creation of God. So yes, thank God for his creation, but what separates you and I from the animal, from sheep, is you and I were made in the image and likeness of God, and every other form of creation was not. That's why the enemy is after you, because when he sees you, he is aware of the image of God. In the days of Noah, Genesis chapter 6, chapter 9, whosoever commits murder, the death penalty shall be enacted. Why? Because they didn't just murder the person. They came against the very image of God. Very important. Where, Lord, I lift your name on high, praise God. Lord, there's none like you, amen. But also be aware of the image of God around you. For how can you say you love God whom you yet not have seen, and yet you are being rough to the image of God, those around you whom you see on a daily basis? Be aware of the image of God around you, especially amongst the house of God. In our marriage class with our blocks, with the guys, I reminded them. How many of you guys here are married? How many of you guys, raise your hands. Up high. Praise God. How many of you are happily married? That was a trick question, wasn't it? That wasn't right, huh? I'm sorry. Am I? No. I reminded the guys married. I said, guys, that wife of yours, you guys remember this? She's not just your wife. She's not just that because of her relationship with the Lord. That's a princess to the throne. And so therefore, God isn't just your God. He's also your father-in-law. Somebody said, ouch. He is both, and the same thing works with you the other way around as well. Ladies, that's not just your cute, handsome stud muffin, you know, prince to the throne, praise God. But because of Christ, and you're both believers, that God is both your God, your daddy, Abba Father, and your father-in-law. And so handle each other ever so carefully. I love that old quote, life is precious, handle with prayer. Remember that? Life is fragile. Life is fragile, handle with prayer. And so here we are, looking at the text. There's a man with a withered hand. It's a stage. It's a staged affair. Something nefarious is in the wind. They brought him in and parked him. They knew that Yeshua has a habit of showing up at synagogue. That's what Luke chapter 4 says. As his custom was, he would show up every Shabbat. People ask you, why do you show up to service every Sunday? Because it's a biblical mandate. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25. Don't forsake the fellowship, the koinonia of the brethren, as is the manner of some, especially as in the day is getting closer. Number one. Number two, it's because Yeshua had a habit of congregating whenever the saints did. And so, good company. Praise God. I thank you guys. I commend you for showing up on a beautiful day like this when you could be working on your tan. Right? And that's true. Some of you need to work on your tan. Some of you, you've been playing hide and seek with the sun. This is where you get arrested. But you made it a priority to come out and be spend time with the Son of God in the corporate gathering of this amazing thing called the Ecclesia, the called out people of God. And so I commend you, and we salute you in the faith, especially those of you out-of-towners. You know, hey, no one knows that you're a believer, but you showed up. How many of you out-of-towners? Raise your hands again. Raise your hands. Give these guys a hand. Give them a hand. We salute you. Because you're on vacation, or if it's longer staycation, y'all came out. We're going to be spending eternity together, so I'm glad I'm getting to know you now. Right? And so, praise God, y'all came out. And so, it's just a commendable thing. I don't think that pastors actually thank people enough for just loving God enough. And I'm going to just hang out with the saints of God before the day takes off. And so, God bless you. God bless you. So they apparently knew that he was en route, and they staged this whole thing. And so he comes up, the same question, different scenario. Is it lawful to heal on Shabbat? And he gives them this value ethics class. Humans are more valuable than sheep. And even if you had one sheep and they went through a little trip mine or something, you would have done everything to pick that thing up. So why this dilemma? Why this conundrum? And then he said to the man, verse 13, say it, stretch out your hand. And he stretched it out, and it was, say it, restored as the other. Then the Pharisees went out and plotted. They plotted with the Herodians against him as to how they might destroy him. Verse 15, but when Yeshua, the salvation of the Lord, knew it, he withdrew from there. He didn't withdraw out of cowardism. He just withdrew in this lag of the journey. He doesn't want to get into a conflict and a crisis with the very nation that he's coming to save. Later on, he would actually reveal himself even more. So now, it's just wisdom. That's where you are. You have fortified your position in this insurrection. Okay, no problem. But you've seen the work of God, and I'm out of here. You need to learn to choose the battles you're in. The trick in life is knowing which bridges to burn and which ones to cross. And so you don't want to be dying in the wrong battlefield. You just got to praise God, amen. And if you need to skedaddle, skedaddle. Get out of there. Need to segue out mercifully. That's what Jesus did many times. Just no problem. The truth has been revealed. We're good. And he's out of there. Somebody said amen. Many, many, many feel that it's our obligation to maintain and be obnoxious. Don't, man. You've shared the truth. You've walked out the truth. Amen. Let God deal with it. God's bigger than you. He's not limited to your presence. So just bow out. Know when to bow out. And if you have that mindset, you will never be susceptible ever again to manipulation, especially amongst families. Families know how to get in there and press the buttons and manipulate you into all kinds of stuff. Love them, pray for them, and share. When it's done, time to get out, time to go, time to go. Got to move, got to move. There's a calling on your life. And so he warned them, verse 15, not to make him known that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet. And here we come to it. What was spoken by Isaiah the prophet? This was in Isaiah chapter 40. Chapter 42. In Isaiah chapter 42, if you want to turn there to, you'll see it, some 600 years prior, there was an aspect of the ministry of Yeshua, the Moshiach, the Messiah, that God showed Isaiah, and it was fulfilled, actually. In these 3.5 years of ministry, it was fulfilled. And this is what Isaiah saw. Isaiah chapter 42. Isaiah chapter 42, Isaiah. Isaiah is the most quoted prophet in Brit Hadashah in the New Testament. The most referenced prophet, the most mentioned prophet in the New Testament, however, is Elijah. Elijah is the most mentioned and referenced, but the most quoted of the prophets is Isaiah's Hanabah. And so let's read here together. The first four verses, behold my servant whom I uphold, my elect one in whom my soul delights. I have put my ruach, my spirit upon him. He will bring forth justice to the uncovenanted people. We have been engrafted in, praise God, the word Gentiles, a people without covenant.
We were outside of the commonwealth of Israel, but through Christ, God is engrafted into the faith of Abraham. Somebody said amen. He will not cry out, nor raise his voice. That's what he did. Those of you who are given to street preaching, this is always the verse I remind them of. If you're going to be out there with the blowhorn, street preaching, talk about the mercies of God and the goodness of God. Never stand there and be obnoxious, because Christ never raised his voice being obnoxious against them. It says it right here. He was the truth, the barometer of glory. He was a friend of sinners. He never compromised, spoke of his love, wept openly, but he never hurled his voice out there in accusatory form. No, he didn't come to judge this world, first coming. He came to save this world. He is returning as a lion in the, of the tribe of Yehuda. And so every time I hear people street preach, I go, you got to be careful. When you get out there, shout about the mercies of God. Amen. Shout about the love of God. Amen. But don't stand there and, oh, you're a sinner and you're a sinner. Whoa, dude, rein it in. Honk your brakes, man. Have you checked the mirror lately? And here's Christ, the salvation of God. But it says he will not shout or raise his voice, nor cause his voice to be heard in the street. Read with me. A bruised reed he will not break. A smoking flax he will not quench. He will bring forth justice for truth. He will not fail nor be discouraged till he has established justice in the earth, and the islands or the coastlands shall wait for his law. That part is to be fulfilled. He came into a world, Yeshua, the salvation of God. We just saw the accusations hurled. We saw the answers given. We saw the actions taken. No, 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 fellas. You want me to roar like a lion now? No, no, no. I'm coming back again in what's known as the second advent. I'm returning, and then I will roar like a lion. This time around, I'm coming as the lamb. I am exhibiting the tenderness and the mercy of the Father towards you. I am his mercy towards you, the Kipporet. I am that unfailing love. I am the goodness of God to you. But listen, there's coming a time where I will return as the judge, and I alone will judge, because I'm the one that died and rose again for you. He will return. Don't expect him to roar as a lion when he, 2 millenniums ago, came as the lamb. No wonder John Yohanan, the immerser, baptizer, says, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And how we believers need to be aware of this. Yes, the world is falling apart. Yes, everything around us is strained. It's getting crazier by the nanosecond. And lawlessness is rife. This world is fraught with decay and corruption. It's a disposable world. It's on its way out. But God has called you and I, though be bold as a lion, be ambassadors of mercy. He didn't come to condemn this world. He came to save it. Everyone knows John 3:16, the theme of Holy Writ. Say it with me. For God so loved the world that he, his only begotten Son, that whoso shall not but have everlasting life. And that's great. Read the other verse. For the Son of Man did not come to condemn the world. So why are Christians so quick to condemn the world, to condemn the lost? He came to save it, and he wants his salvation message to come through the church. But there's coming a day. While the die has already been cast, there's coming a day when he'll say, all right, for Noah, it was 120 years of building the ark and preaching as a preacher of righteousness until God says that day has arrived. The Bible says God then closed the door to the ark. There's coming a day, but that day hasn't come yet. Until the judgment of God is wrought out through the Son of God, when he splits the constellation, he splits the skies upon his appearing. Until that day, be salt, be light, but be merciful. Be salt and be light, but be kind and be good. Tell people, God's not mad with you yet. Give your life to the salvation of God now. Look at the goodness of God. We implore you, Paul says, by the mercies of God, not by the judgment. Judgment is coming, yes, but we're not there yet. Why is it that this nation, 240 years,
is still standing today. I can tell you why. There are different measures of judgment all throughout the nations, different levels, but I can tell you what's holding this nation together. Are you ready? It's the mercies of God. God's goodness towards these people, towards you, towards your forefathers, towards the founding fathers of the republic. God's goodness resonates. That doesn't mean you ought to compromise, because Jesus never, when they got healed, when they got forgiven, he said, go and sin no more. Pick up your cross. Okay, I get it. I get it. But there is such a dearth for mercy and kindness and gentleness in a world where the reed has been so bruised. He was born into a bruised world. He was born into a bruised neighborhood, a bruised society. This world has been bruised since the fall of Adam. It's bruised even more so now. But look at the goodness of God. Look at it back in Matthew chapter 12. Look at it. I will put my spirit upon him. Behold, that's a powerful word. Behold means, hey, wake up and see. My dolos, my servant, my shamash, whom I have chosen. Read verse 18, Matthew. My beloved in whom my soul is, say it. Is what? My soul delighteth in, says King James. The birthplace of every ministry is knowing, really knowing experientially God's love for you. God, you must know the love of God towards you, for you, and through you. And even though there is not a verse that says, if you were the only person on earth, Christ would have died for you, theologically, it is biblical. Jesus, well done. This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Until you know that you know that you know God's love for you through Christ, you will never be totally released in the work of God. It's the love of Christ that compels us. Not the law. It's the love of Christ that catapults us, says the apostles. And no wonder Paul says, oh, my prayer for you is you must know the depth and the height and the width and the breadth of God's love for you. How many of you would be content as just knowing that God loves you? And the evidence of that love is Christ came, died, and rose again for you. And that is enough. Lord, you love me. And I know this because you died and rose again for me. No other so-called demagogue, no other in the quandary of messes of ideologies and the plethora of, no one did. You did. You loved me and died for me and rose again for me. No one else done that. That should be enough for you. Many Christians give their life to the Lord and they will spend the entirety of the balance of their life trying to earn, because we have been raised with love has got to be meritorious. And God says, no, you can't. You don't deserve it. I'm just giving it to you because I am God. Now take it. What? Wait. It goes against our grain. It rubs our ego and our pride raw because I need to do something. No, just surrender. What? No, just receive it. But why are you doing this? Why are you doing this? Because of who I am. It has nothing to do with you. It's who I am. I'm just doing this intrinsically because I love you. And when you receive that love, you're transformed. You're looking to someone who's a former atheist raised in witchcraft, never had the ability to speak until God saved me and my voice, languages came forth. The love of God can never, ever be counterfeited by the hordes of hell. They may be able to mimic some things, but when it comes to the love of God, the forgiveness of God, the redemption of God, they're out of their quarter, they're out of their depth. They can't touch this. Can't touch it. Even the angels stand back in awe at the price God would pay for salvation and the silver, the redemption of mere mortals. The angels are struck by it. They go, you know. We're told that in Peter's that the angels, they didn't, what? Even though they're mightier than you and I in strength, only one angel cleaned out 187,000 Assyrians in less than 24 hours. Was it even working overtime? They're stronger than you and I. They're wiser than you and I. And yet they're astounded. They are learning lessons about God's goodness through the interaction of the Holy Ghost and your availability to God. They're learning. They're taking notes. You go, wow, that's pretty amazing. Never seen that. That's amazing. You know, they're not as much intergalactic as they are interdimensional. They can step in and step out of our reality. One day we shall see them. This veneer shall be lifted. And if you are faithful, you're going to rule over them. You'll judge over them one day. So stay faithful. So turn to your neighbor and say, stay faithful. Stay faithful. Everyone's looking forward to the rapture, as am I, but there's something more glorious. Be a part. Pray that you are faithful enough to be being a part of Christ's millennial administration, where for 1,000 years you can administrate because you've been faithful here with the mammon of man. You've been faithful in this world. Look forward to that. Rapture? Psh, that's nothing. Praise God, for it'll happen whenever it happens, but I want to be a part. I don't care if I'm a doorman, but just put me in that administration. Somebody said, amen. Look beyond the horizon, folks. But mercy. We're coming back here to mercy. Behold my servant whom I have chosen, my beloved in whom my soul is well. I will put my spirit upon him. He will declare justice to the uncovenantal people. He will not quarrel nor cry out. Every now and then people ask me, hey, Pastor Easy, you guys want to go into a debate? You know, I don't do debates, you know. Christ didn't debate. Truth is on a realm of its own. A lie, because it is contrived, has got to be defended. Truth is just on its realm. It's on its own. You know. I walk away. Nor will anyone hear his voice in the streets. And we come down to this. A bruised reed. Say it. A bruised reed out loud. He will not what? There are three applications to these. The reed is a thin bamboo-like shoot plant, botanically speaking. It's hollowed out in the middle, and they're found in two terrains. They're either in the water, in the mush, right? And they're all there in the thickets. Or they're on land, and they're bendable by the wind. And sometimes if the strain of the waves in the ocean as it ebbs and flows, it could actually create a little tear in this little reeds. And sometimes in that bruising, they would actually break off. The waves of lawlessness, the waves of adversity. We're in a fragmented and bruised world, like in the days of Jesus. And things, the weight is actually shifting, and there's more weight now than ever before. You know that in our generation, actually since the, not just 21st, since the 20th generation, in the 20th century, the word stress has taken a whole new level of meaning. Because only in the 20th century did we have the ability to actually implode the world by the press of a button. Before that, all the TNT, all the muskets, all the bayonets couldn't come close to it. But only in the 20th century did we have the ability to weaponize and destroy the world. Now it's quantum leap forward, 21st century. Now it's like, wow. So there's the meaning of stress has quadrupled and takes a whole new dress code in our day than ever before. Because back then, hey, I don't like your nation. You said this to my nation. I'm sending 100,000 troops over. No, that's back in the day. Now I'm pressing the button. The troops are staying home. I'm pressing a button. Enjoy your unscheduled sunshine. That's a whole new level of drama there. And the people of God, you and I, in this generation, we ought to be more prayerful now than ever before because of that. So we pray for the nation. We pray for those that hold the football, that hold this case that has the ability to. We pray for them. Hello? Are you still there with me? The waves, the torrential waves are upon the lives of people around you, maybe even your life. There's breaking in the foundations of marriage. The waves are coming in and they're not letting up. And what does Christ say? I recognize that you're a bruised reed. I see it. You're hollowed out in the middle. Nothing can sustain you from within. I see it. But you know what? I will not break a bruised reed. I will come in as the mender. And I will straighten you out and I will hold you together. I will pursue you, and I will restore you. I will regather you to myself. I will fill your hollowness with my love and my mercy, and you will stand when everyone else around you is falling. This is a call for evangelism. The world around us, your workmates, your peers, your bosses, they are bruised reeds and they're about to break. And God's got you exactly where he wants you. And you are called to be an oasis to minister to these people, strengthen them. And maybe your life this morning is exactly such. We're a bruised reed. Things are just wearing us down, and we're in the waves or on dry land, and the wind of adversity is just doing its thing. Adversity is an inevitable part of human life. Some get more than others, but it's part of human life. There is a segment of Christian reality teaching that's erroneous and diabolical. They teach that if you are a believer in Christ, you're supposed to walk through life exempt from suffering, exempt from adversity. That somehow, if you prayed hard enough and long enough, because your faith is not in the faithfulness of God, your faith is in faith, your own faith. If you pray long enough and hard enough, that the Spirit of God will actually airlift you from mountaintop to mountaintop, avoiding the prairies and the doldrums and all the valleys. You can just skip from air, be airlifted from mountaintop to mountaintop. And this is what they. And when you go through stuff, they look at you and they judge you, like Job's compadres. You know, they look at you. And I go, show me any star, any general, any person of faith who was worth their salt in the Bible, and I'll show you some that went through measures of suffering. Hoping to go through life without struggle is like wanting to swim in the Great Barrier Reef and somewhat buying into the lie that you may, believing that I won't get, bitten by a shark because I have an aquarium at home. So somehow it's folly. Buying into the lie, thinking that you will live life exempt, free from suffering, is as obnoxious, is as foolish as someone wearing red in the middle of a rodeo, being stared down by the bull and saying, I'm of no threat, it will not approach me because I'm a vegetarian. No, it doesn't work that way. But when suffering comes, thank God for the grace of God that's faithful and sufficient. Give the Lord a hand, would you please? Yes, it's coming. And some people more than others, especially if you really tune in to being on fire for Jesus. Oh, man, higher levels, higher devils. But the grace of God is sufficient. And you press in. And you stay the course. And the body will gather around you and stand with you. That's what we're told in James chapter 5, verse 11. Just jot that down. So bruised reed, he will not break. Some of you here, You're about to cast away confidence because hope deferred makes the heart sick. I'm tired. My wife is not there yet. She's not. My husband's not there yet. And I just don't know what to do. You hang in there and you surrender to Jesus because the bruised reed, he will not break. And you give that stuff over to him. Stop handling it. Give it to him. He sees the areas in our lives where we are fractured, but let's surrender to him. And let's see what he will do. And that's the prophecy of Yeshua. That now, it's amazing because from a musical standpoint, the third application here, is they would make flutes out of these reeds in the Middle East, Middle Earth. They would actually make this. And every now and then, when the flute and these reeds would get dry out of usage, they would actually, it would lose its ability to actually sing. And then they would start avoiding those three pipes at the end, and then eventually the whole thing. There's more that's junk than there is that's applicable. And so what the musicians now has is two options. Either he would actually clean it out, put some oil, and kind of wait on it, the season, or he would just kind of put it underfoot and step on it. Aren't you glad that when we're broken, Jesus doesn't step on us, either? Aren't you glad that there's still a song in you? Aren't you glad that there's still something glorious in your life? If you have breath, there is hope. There's a call of God in your life. Aren't you glad that the calling of God is given without repentance, irrevocably? Aren't you glad that God doesn't just say, enough? Even though many Christians do, many churches do. The Christian church is the only army that's known for shooting its wounded.
we should be a bit more sensitive. Lord, help me be a bit more sensitive to those around me that are bruised. That's why we hang out with people. Hang out with you. We go out and visit those in the hospital. I'm a chaplain for the children's hospital. Why? They may be smiling, but there's a bruising there. And God wants his people to be like the healing balm of Gilead. Let's go in there and let's love with his people. We take food, by the way, every two Tuesdays, first and third. We take food to them, take dinner, and we eat with them and hang out with them. We play board games with them. Then we pray for them, minister to them. Why? Because they're bruised. They're here from Fiji, my homeland, from Samoa, from Tonga, from the Marquesas, from Micronesia, up there in East Oak. Christmas Island, Marshallese, and they're bruised, and God's calling the church. The world is bruised, and yet what are we doing? This was so revolutionary. Those who were in darkness saw a light. Yeshua came to a bruised world, and he began to just soothe and minister to. And yet the church was still incubated. He called us to be fishers of men, but we are so busy still being keepers of the aquarium. We're to be salt and light, be equipped, and get out there. There's a bruised people waiting for you. You are to be Jesus to them on deck. But first, be filled with the love of God. First, be filled with the Spirit of God. And then go out there to a world and be poured out as a drink offering. Be poured out. Take the bread of life and share with them and see what God will do. But you cannot give what you don't have. And so stay connected with the Lord and let him heal the bruised areas of our lives, the areas that's hurt with distrust and mental abuse or whatever it is. I'm surrendering to you, the mender of broken dreams. There's a bruising here and I don't want to break in the world. They got nothing for me. But say it with me, a bruised reed, say it. You will not break. And a smoking flax, he will not quench. A smoking flax is a little lantern and a little wick, the wick that's been kept alive by the oil. But once the oil is dry, the wick begins to flicker, and there's a little bit of smoke left. Until that little lantern is replenished with fresh oil, it will die out. And sometimes what they do is when they just smell smoke, a little bit of smoke, oh, yeah, okay. They get over there, and if there's no oil or if it's time to kind of expire, they just bring a little hat, and they close that little lantern off, and it kills off the whole thing. And some of us, some of you here, that's your life. You've been on fire for Jesus. But yet something has come into your life and the oil is running dry. You're a hair shy of empty. And there's smoke. And you're calling out, Lord, I thought I was on fire. I don't even have smoke. And God says, okay, come to me, those who are weary and heavy laden. And I will visit. I will not snuff out that thing. I will put some oxygen in there and bring you alive again. At the brink of giving up, at the brink of desperation and destitute, thank God the anastasis, the resurrection, is still the life giver. Give the Lord a hand, would you please? A smoking flax, he will not quench. I need more of the Spirit of God in my life, more of the love of God in my life, in your workplace, in your marriage, whatever it is. How many of you would say, I'm a reed and I've been bruised, and I thank God that my Savior will not break me. He will restore me. Raise your hand right where you are. Let me see you. Keep your hands up. How many of you, I am that wick that's running out of oil, but I thank God he will not quench it. Raise your hand. Let me see you. Amen. Amen. That's the God that we serve. Meets us exactly where we are. That's the uniqueness of Yeshua. We've always missed this. He fulfilled this 2 millenniums ago, the latter part to be realized in the millennium. But he is the same yesterday, today, and forever, and he is right here with you and I. Will you let God into your bruised rib, into your bruised reed, and will you let him just begin to bind you up? A few verses here in closing. Matthew 11. 28 to 30. Come to me, all who are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. That's all he asks us to do. Come to me. Let me bind you up. Come to me. Let me pour new stuff into you. Let me just love upon you. Come to me. Two verses to end with here. Turn with me to Psalms chapter 103. As you turn there, just say it with me, God is so good. In fact, before Psalms 103, go to Psalms 147. Psalms 147. Oh, there's hope for the hurting. Can you say that? There is. There's hope for the hurting. The compassion and the mercies of God through Yeshua is just astounding. Psalms 147. Read with me, verses 1 to verse 3. Praise the Lord, for it is good to sing praises to our God, for it is pleasant and praise is beautiful. Yehovah builds up Jerusalem. He gathers together the outcasts of Israel. Say it out loud. He heals the brokenhearted and he binds up their wounds. They're brokenhearted people. Decimated dreams. The reed is bruised. They need to know that there is a Savior who will bind up that reed and not break it. He is so sensitive and so gentle. We need to be so sensitive and so gentle in ministering to people and sharing the love of Jesus with them. We need to catch these things. The rate of suicide, law enforcement, our Leo heroes, the suicide rates, our veterans' suicide rates. It's appalling. It is appalling. It is devastating. I pray for their families and I pray for the church. Those are bruised reeds and they're broken. Where is the church? What are we doing about this great commission that he's called us to go out and be ambassadors of mercy to this place? Pray for them. Pray for this. Their kids they apparently need a consent letter from the parental guardians at home to take an aspirin, but they don't need consent for abortion. And they're guilt-ridden. And we need to be praying for them. And some of your times, please come out with us if you can to having a service out there, the community service, praying with the homeless people as we go about. Do something. Be Jesus. Exemplify his love, man. This world is bruised and tattered and broken, but there's only one. And the only one that can do something about it is calling his church to engage the world. So stay engaged. Stay engaged. Now go over with me to Psalms 103. As you turn there, sing with me. Bless the Lord, all my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Everybody say it again. Oh, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. He has done great things. He has done great things. He has done great things. Bless his holy name. Now that we've sang the first verse, let's read verse 2. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from destruction, who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies your mouth with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. Who crowns us with loving kindness and what? And what? Say it again. Say, God has crowned me with loving kindness and what? Tender mercies. There it is. In his goodness, in his greatness, his loving kindness pours through his tender mercies. And so, what is the Lord doing in your life now? What is he saying to you even so now? How many of you would say, I need just to be grounded in the love of God for me? The prayer of Paul. If that's you, just raise your hand. Lord, I just need that revelation of your love, your mercies for me. Just raise your hand right where you are. Let me see you. It's the absence of this that makes us so harsh in everything else that we do. But Lord, I need a revelation of your love and your mercy for me. If that's you, right where you are, just begin to talk to the Lord right there. Lord, very simple. I cannot put words in your mouth, and I don't intend to, but just right there, talk to the Lord. Lord, I need a revelation, a greater revelation of your love and your mercy. Or maybe, Lord, I just sorry for allowing the birds of prey to come and snuff out that truth. Lord, would you? I thank you for your mercy and for your love for me today. Maybe that's where it's a good place to start. Just thank God for that. Thank you, Lord. Mahalo, Jesu Christo, for your aloha, for your love, for your mercies for me. Transform me with your love and your mercies, Lord. How many of you right there would say, when I came in this morning, I know for a fact that I'm a bruised reed, that I am a lantern out of oil and just smoking, about to be snuffed out. And yet the Lord in his goodness is doing something in restoring me right now. If that's you, stand to your feet. Let me see you. Stand to your feet. If that's you, I'm a bruised reed. I came in as a bruised reed, and this morning I'm sensing God's love. Like the waves here upon the rocks behind me, I just sense the mercies of God, the goodness of God beginning to, you know, there's fire in my lantern again. That's you. Just stand to your feet. Let me see you. Let me see you. One person. Two person. Anyone else? Anyone else? How many of you would actually say, I actually need prayers right now. I am that bruised reed, and I need prayers right now. I'd like to have you guys pray for me. If that's you, let me see you. Let me see you. Anybody? Who is it? Who is that bruised reed? Who is that? Audience of one here. Who is that little lantern that's about to be snuffed out, and today God wants to restore you? Who is it? Let me see you. We will not allow a word from the Lord to come forth and there be no response to it. God is too awesome, too majestic for that. Amen. Who is it? One person here. Anyone else? Anyone else? I am that bruised reed. And today, anyone else? Back over there? Anyone else over there? Stand to your feet, my sister. Let me see you. Anyone else? I'm a bruised reed. And today, by the Spirit of God, I'm trusting God to just do what only God can do. I'm a lantern. My wick is actually smoking. And today, come forward, you guys, come forward. Come on up. Anyone else? Come on up. Anyone else? I'm a lantern, and today I'm just glad that my flame will not quench. Stand right at the front up there, you guys. Stand right up there. Anyone else? Thank you, Lord. Budding Rods, may have you guys come up. Come stand with our brothers and sisters here. Before we pray for you, just right there, you've heard the word of the Lord. Just surrender to him. Okay? Surrender to him. Lord, I am that bruised reed. I thank you that you will not let me break today. Lord, I am that lantern. But Lord, I thank you today that you will set me on fire. Just start thanking him that way. Start thanking him that way. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Just turn whatever that thing is or those things are just between you and the Lord. Turn it over to the Lord. Turn it over. Cast your cares upon him. Why? Because he's crazy about you. Because he cares for you. And receive his mercies. Receive his grace. Receive his aloha in a fresh way. For perfect love cast out all fear. Just declare his lordship in your life. If you have loved ones and they're going through stuff, take this moment and pray for them. Pray for them and pray for the Lord to open up a door for you to share with them. If you have loved ones that are going through stuff. The waves are just about to dash upon them. The winds on the land is about to break that reed. It's about to snuff out that flame. Pray for them right now. Pray for them. May not be your loved ones. Maybe people that you work with or people you work for. Pray for them. Pray for them. And then avail yourself to the Spirit of God to use you to be a source of blessing and oasis, to be the conduit through the river of life to these amazing people. Cast your cares to the Lord. He cares for you. Cast all of your cares. Don't hang on to some of the other stuff. Cast it all upon the Lord. For He cares for you. Thank you, Lord. Let's sing it together. Let's all stand together. Let's sing it together. You are my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I see. You are my all. Seeking you as a precious jewel, Lord, to give up beautiful, you are my own. Jesus, heaven's Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, heaven's Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Taking my sin, my cross, my shame, rising again, I bless your name. You are my all in all. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my all in all. Let's raise our voices together. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is. See it again. Jesus, Lamb of God. Oh, yes, Lord. Oh, so awesome are you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your compassion. Thank you for your mercies, O God. Thank you, Lord, today for your compassion, for your mercies, your forbearance, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you will never give up on your people, Lord. Thank you for your relentless pursuit of us, Lord. We thank you for your first love. We thank you for your tender mercies, Lord. We ask more of you, Lord. You must increase, and we will decrease, O God. Baruch Hashem Adonai, Melech Ha'olam. Blessed be your name forever, Malkuto of Le'olam Vaed. Oh, we thank you, Lord. We thank you as you strengthen your house with your spirit, with your love. Help us discern, Lord, the bruised reed around us, Lord, and help us be ministers of mercy and loving kindness to them. Thank you, Father, for your goodness today. Let's raise our hands to the heavens together in the benediction. And now to him who is able to keep us from stumbling and to present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To God our Savior, who alone is wise, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. And the saints of God said, Lord, sanctify the food and the fellowship. If you are here, you want to know more about it, you want to be born again, get up here. Come on up here, and we will share Christ with you. Believe in the Son of God. He alone saves. He is the mercies of God exemplified. The Lord bless you. Lord bless you. Service is over. The church has left the building, gone fishing.